stories of my life, because I know that my children in later years, my transgender community will understand. We have to stand up and speak for ourselves. We have to fight for ourselves. We saved their lives. We were the front liners of the so-called 1969 rebellion of the Stonewall. I don't know how long I'm going to be around, but I wanted to be told the way I feel.
Sylvia and I talked about it when she was in the hospital, and really neither one of us could come up with why we, of all people, stayed friends for 33 years. I've always said we were the oddest of odd couples, because I was in my 40s at that time. Sylvia was 19. Sylvia was basically a Puerto Rican street drag queen. We didn't have transgendered people in those days. I was a WASP who had come out of the establishment. The Stonewall was peculiar. It meant many things to many people. Here was a riot, and here, for the first time, well, first time any of us was seeing gays fight back. I think one of the things that impressed Sylvia most was the line of street kids doing the Rockette, "We Are the Stonewall Girls," because I mean, this was in total defiance. This was getting out and saying to the world, to the police, to everybody, "I'm a little faggot," and it was, "We are the Stonewall Girls, we wear our hair in curls, we don't wear underwear, we show our pubic hair." It certainly was the turning point in the life of Sylvia Rivera.
The one aspect of Sylvia's activism going all the way back to 1970 in Star House was the specific issue of dealing with the homeless transgender population. And
Star House came out of the organization STAR, which stood for Street Transvestite Action Revolutionaries, and it was the brainstorm of Sylvia, Marsha P. Johnson, and Bubbles Rose Lee.
Marsha and Sylvia got a hold of this building, and they were using it, it's sort of the model for Transy House here, in fact, as a kind of collective place for the trans girls that were out living on the street, you know, homeless. Marsha and Sylvia mothered them. I mean, they mothered everybody. So I considered Sylvia to be my mother. Everybody in this house called her Ma. I mean, she was well, that's what she was.
Sylvia left the movement after the first three or four years, because in this very park, she had been refused the right to speak. And it was right here with the rally after one of the Pride marches.
It was like the fourth anniversary gay march when I was beat up on stage.
Y'all better quiet down.
What the bullshit?
Sylvia did grab the mic and speak, and she roared,
"Revolution now! Give me a G! Give me an A! Give me a Y! Give me a P! Give me an O! Give me a W! Give me an E! Give me an R!
I have never seen anyone so lost. I mean, Sylvia's world had suddenly just collapsed. And Sylvia left the movement for 20 years.
I've known Sylvia informally, you might say, since 1969, 1970, the Gay Activist Alliance. We were arch enemies for the first 22 years of the 32 years we knew one another. And that is story, which I think is so remarkable, the person that I used to consider a very arch enemy or moral political enemy, someone I had no use for whatsoever, ended up becoming one of my best friends in life and literally came in here and ran my business and became one of the most special, wonderful, incredible people I ever knew. How many people have one of their worst enemies or oldest enemy become one of their best friends and saviors?
Have you ever spent a winter in these, in, you know, like out of doors in an environment like this?
I spent winters with Marsha and some of the other drag queens many years ago before Star House, and during the beginning of Star House, out in the street. But it wasn't like this. This is like a complete new atmosphere for me.
They didn't have homeless encampments in those days.
We slept in hallways, or either Marsh or I had a hotel room where we snuck everybody in, you know.
The pier was actually established a few years before I got here. I came down to be nosy and I moved in and took over basically as the big mother that I am. Over here, this was part of my house.
This is my little segment of the house, because Vinny and Tom live on that side. You can mm-hmm. go and film. It's, you know, very... This is my closet where I keep my clothes, you know.
Any gowns?
Yeah, all the gowns, you know, I don't need them. I was comfortable for a lot of years, you know. Like I said, we owned a house. My lover and I did own a house. And actually what happened, you know, it's been like 3 years is when I got that telegram that Marsha was dead. I mean, I lost a lot of my incentive to do anything. When she died, part of me went with her because one of our pacts was that we would always cross River Jordan together. And to me, this is the River Jordan, the Hudson River. This is not my first time that I've hit bottom as far as, you know, because of my drinking and whatnot, but what's given me a lot of incentive right now is like being back in the village instead of being in Westchester and keeping myself confined from what my life has always been is to fight for something.
Because most of the kids here were alcoholics and people with AIDS. And that's one of the reasons that I stayed on for as long as I did until we got thrown out, because there were people here that really needed help and the community was not here to help them.
But it hurts to see that people are not being helped. I may spend the winter out here for the simple fact that if I can't see them off the street, why should I go get shelter for myself? Because right now, I have to prove a point as a Stonewall veteran. I find myself back in this situation, but as I look at the river a lot of times, and Marsha gives me a lot of strength, is that I gotta keep fighting for somebody. Marsha was a fighter. We were both fighters. I actually feel her spirit telling me, you gotta keep fighting, girlie, because it's not time for you to cross
the River Jordan. After the interview on the pier in 96, we became very good friends, because then she came here and started working stringing Christmas ornaments. It was just incredible. You know, I said to myself, I said, she wants to work at the store. This queen is gonna last 3 hours a day, you know, 2 days at the most, please, no, you know, but, oh, I'll give her a shot. You know what I mean? Like, it was just enough where I said, oh, I'll give her, you know, I'll give anybody a try. You know what I mean? And then in my amazement, she turned out to be incredible. They tell me, my computer man just told me a couple weeks ago, I didn't know this at the time, but when I would really be getting on Sylvia's nerves, she'd become humming this tune. Yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today.
In 95, about, I was at a thing Clags was doing up on 42nd Street at the university there, and they had the last panel was this thing on Stonewall, and Sylvia was there, And I was like, hey, remember me? I'm one of your kids, you know, that sort of thing. And where you been?
I guess I was intrigued by her, you know, when I first saw her. She had a lot of energy, you know.
She was talking about how she'd been homeless and she'd been living on a pier and that sort of thing. And I said, hey, you're not homeless. I got a place. As long as I got a place, you're not homeless. Yeah, that sort of thing, you know. So she didn't move in right away, but she started coming around, you know. Julia had been close with me and Rusty, and she was living here with us at the time.
I just started spending a lot of time with her.
She asked if she could stay here. The idea was she was going to live here. She'd do some work in the backyard, do some work around the house in lieu of paying rent.
Maybe this would be more important to me than it would be to her, because when we first moved in together, she was decorating, you know, and that was when Pokemon was first starting, so she liked Pikachu, and so I bought one of these for her.
The first couple of years were hardest, because when she first moved in, I mean, I loved Sylvia to death, but she was a hardcore alcoholic. I mean, she was an unqualified drunk.
When she moved here, she would drink every day.
I mean, she would come home from work, sit down in a chair, open her second or third quart of vodka for the day, and that was about it.
She spent all her time in the living room downstairs, and she slept down there and watched TV down there, and I just remember, you know, I wanted to do things for her, you know, and she used to go like this to me when I would come in, you know, and I'd go back like that to her, and she used to call me an angel, you know, because I guess of the fact that I was helping her, you know. And
Julia would come in to help Sylvia, so I mean, I saw this relationship literally take root and grow.
And Julie and Sylvia became an item.
Chelsea, you know, asked me whether we were lovers, and so I asked her. And she,
you know, I mean, they almost became inseparable, and then that got where you never saw one without the other.
I was at work, and she said, you know, she came up to me and said, well, I've been thinking about it all day, you know, and she said, I've decided we are lovers.
But what was so incredible is that Julia did something for Sylvia that no one else in the world ever did.
After a while, Sylvia quit drinking. Apparently, you know, the relationship with Julia gave her some impetus for doing that.
Julia kept Sylvia sober.
No one has ever been as enthusiastic about me as she was. I mean, she was like, she would, you know, she'd caress me like I was a gift.
Julia gave Sylvia that extra leg she needed.
And then she got, like, incredibly politically active again and started doing some really wonderful work. And, you know, she was more her.
She really was ferocious when she got sober.
Straight on, you know.
Right.
Powerful, you know.
She was totally responsible. I mean, first time in her life, I was just so proud of her. And I used to tell her constantly, and it used to make her so happy. And she used to say to me, oh, I'm so happy when you tell me you're proud of me.
She rose above circumstances. I mean, she getting me, you know, a child prostitute at the age of 10, you know, and a drug addict, and all these awful experiences that went on in her life. And you would have thought that she would have just, as she got older, would have gotten uglier and more mm-hmm. twisted. And instead, somehow, she went through this roller coaster ride of tragedy and suddenly bloom like a new rose of spring or something. Mm-hmm. I should say an opium poppy.
I mean, other people can talk about this better than I can. I mean, she got religion at the end of her life. She was very actively involved in the MCC.
She came to the church about 4 years ago and began attending on Sunday on a regular basis. She began volunteering in the food pantry, which serves people who are living in poverty in the city and also people living with AIDS. And eventually, the director of our food pantry resigned, and we hired Sylvia as the director of the food pantry.
I call these, but I have them lined up like this, my soldiers to fight hunger. That's my little nickname.
Sylvia had a very deep, deep passion for people living in poverty in this city, not just the trans community, not just the queer community, but anybody who didn't have the kind of housing or the kind of clothing or the kind of medical care or the kind of resources that it really takes to survive, much less live, in New York City.
I can go home and say that I've actually tried to make a difference. And not sit down and talk about it, but plan to do something about it.
She just had this way about her that people from all walks of life would end up here getting groceries or lunches or some kind of food or clothing or housing assistance from us, and she really helped us, I think, develop that ministry and take it the next step.
It makes me feel good that we're able to reach a few people, but in the long run, it's still not enough, but every little bit helps.
The other thing that will always stick with me is when we were really wrestling with Sonda, she came to me one day and asked me if I understood what I was doing in terms of calling for an inclusive Sonda, if I knew what that meant. And I said that I did. It meant that I wouldn't leave her behind. She didn't let people go blindly into the positions that they took. She wanted to make sure that you understood what you were saying, what you might be giving up, what you might be sacrificing in order to stand with her. And I really admire that kind of, not only forthrightness, but that kind of honesty and integrity.
The transgender movement is very marginalized, and she had a vision, and she continued to fight for that vision.
Even Matt Foreman and Joe Graybars had come to have a meeting with her in the hospital and about the Sonda bill, and Sylvia was, you know, so anxious to get that passed before she died.
I mean, on your own deathbed, to summons ESPA, the people from the Empire State Agenda Committee, to your deathbed to plead the case, don't leave my people behind. Brilliant strategy.
I didn't sit in on the meeting. I went out to get something to eat, but Reverend Pat sat in on the meeting.
There were four of us, actually, in her room. Matt and Joe agreed to come to her hospital bedside and meet with her about Sonda.
And when I came back up, Sylvia was extremely happy. Whatever they had said satisfied Sylvia.
She was able to actually negotiate in an amazingly competent way as she lay there in her hospital bed and got ESPA to agree to having a trans person on their board of directors and was able to present her list of demands to them.
I knew how it would feel to be free.
I don't think we should, as a community, pass the bill unless it's all inclusive. I mean, it's all or nobody. But unfortunately, most of the gay community doesn't agree with it. And they want the bill passed without this amendment on it.
I wish I could share all the love that's in my heart. Remove all the bars that keep us apart. I wish you could know what it means to be me. Then you'd see and agree that every man should be free. I wish I could give all I'm longing to give. I wish I could live
like I'm